We're going to get started here. So I just want to welcome everybody to our speaker tonight. And I want to let you know a little bit about Historic New England if you're not familiar with us. My name is Claire Sadar and I'm the program manager here. And we are the largest and oldest regional preservation organization in the country. And I'm going to hand it over to Ken Torino to introduce our speaker. He is going to be handling the questions tonight as well. So if you have questions, please put them in the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen. And Ken will ask those at the end of our session. And if you have any problems that you need to alert me to, you can always send a chat. So I'm going to hand it over to Ken.
Thank you, Claire. I'm delighted. Thank you all for coming tonight. I'm really very pleased to have our speaker here tonight, who is a colleague who I've had the pleasure of being on a panel with and knowing of her work for years. Dr. Gretchen Sullivan Sorin is director and distinguished service professor at the Cooperstown Graduate Program, a training program for museum curators, educators, and directors. It's part of the State University of New York at Oneata. Dr. Sorin holds a BA from Rutgers University in American Studies, an MA in Museum Studies from the Cooperstown Graduate Program, and a PhD from the University of Albany in American History. Dr. Sorin has more than 30 years of experience in the museum profession, working for more than 250 museums as a museum exhibition curator and educator, programming and interpretive planning, and strategic planning consultant. She has served as a guest curator for many exhibitions. I'm just going to mention a few of the major ones, including In the Spirit of Martin, The Living Legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and that was for the Smithsonian Institution Traveling Exhibition Service, Through the Eyes of Others, African Americans and Identity and American Art, the nationally acclaimed traveling exhibition, Bridges and Boundaries, African Americans and American Jews for the Jewish Museum in New York. She's very active in the museum community and for the past 20 years has worked to broaden representation in the museum field for underrepresented groups. She has served on the boards or governing councils of organizations, just to mention a few, the New York Folklore Society, the American Association for State and Local History, the 1772 Foundation, and the New York State Parks Commission, many more. Now, Dr. Sorin writes and lectures frequently on museum practice, diversity and inclusion, and African-American histories. Her books include Touring Historic Harlem, Four Walks in Northern Manhattan with architectural historian Andrew Dalkart, In the Spirit of Martin, The Living Legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., for the Smithsonian Institution Traveling Exhibition Service. And she is here tonight to talk about her latest publication, Driving While Black, African-American Travel and the Road to Civil Rights. I've just finished the book. It was absolutely amazing. So I think you're in for a real treat. Dr. Sorin is also the co-writer and senior historian who worked with Rick Burns on the documentary film, I hope you had the chance to see, last month on PBS, Driving While Black, Race, Space, and Mobility. And I did, and it was absolutely also amazing. So with that, it's my pleasure to turn this over to Dr. Sorin.
Thank you, Ken, and thanks so much. I'm going to share my screen. Just give me a minute. Is it working? Okay. And to get everybody in the mood to think about the time period, I'm just gonna play a little bit of music. Here we go.
Well, you know that every child running for Jesus,
like an automobile.
Every child of God running for Jesus,
just like an automobile.
So today I am going to talk a little bit about mobility. And that's what really got me into a study of the automobile and what mobility actually means for the African American community and how central mobility is to freedom in American life. I'd like you to think about your own mobility for a minute. Think about how important it is to you. It's something we all take for granted, but how important is it to you to be able to go where you want to go, when you want to go, to be able to just take your car and to be able to travel any place in the country, whether you fly or drive. I think Americans got a little bit of a taste of what restricted mobility was like this past spring when we were all locked down and we really couldn't travel. We couldn't go any place. And various states, especially in the Northeast, started to put restrictions in place on travel. And it's not the same as the restrictions that were placed on African Americans, certainly, but it was just a little taste of how important our mobility is to us. So in thinking about this topic of mobility, we have to go all the way back to the beginning. We have to begin with slavery, because it's during slavery that mobility was first restricted. For African Americans, as soon as they arrived on these shores, mobility was denied. They couldn't travel where they wanted. If an enslaved person wanted to travel, they had to have a pass. And those passes might look like this, which is a paper pass. This is, it says, please to let Benjamin McDaniel pass from Dr. Henkel's in Newmarket, Shenandoah County to and return on Monday to Mount Pelier. And it's for Mrs. Madison, that's Mrs. James Madison in 1843. So you either had to have a paper pass or you had to have a little metal pass that was attached to your clothing. So African-Americans who wanted their freedom, who wanted the freedom of mobility, took it. They took their freedom by running away. And this is a famous painting in the collection of the Brooklyn Museum. And of course, we have to, in order to understand this story, in order to understand this history, we really need to think about the foundation of the modern police department. Where did our police departments come from? And many of the earliest police departments were formed as slave catchers. And here you can see an early policeman. And these were, of course, legal entities. These were the citizens of a community that gathered together every night with their lanterns to make sure that any African Americans that they found outside of their homes or on the roads were carrying passes, that they had permission to be away from their plantations and away from their masters, that they weren't runaways. And of course, the other reason for these slave catchers was intimidation, you know, to make sure that people knew that if they were caught, they would be beaten or very severely punished. So these are our early police departments. And if you see, wait a minute, there, if you see the badges, that they were really deputized and they carried these badges. And you can see the one on the left, it says Runaway Slave Patrol. These look very much like our modern police badges. So this is the foundation. The earliest police departments were going out looking for enslaved Africans, making sure that they weren't in the quote wrong place, places they were not supposed to be. If you're thinking about the journey of African Americans from slavery to freedom, the next step would be the Great Migration. The Great Migration is really the largest migration of people in the history of the United States. And as many as 6 million African Americans moved from the rural South to the North and to the West. And they moved to cities like Boston, like Philadelphia, like Newark, New Jersey, like New York City, Detroit, Los Angeles. And they brought all of their possessions. Now, it was very dangerous for African Americans in the South to go to a train station because the train stations were monitored. They, of course, the Southerners didn't want to lose their labor force. And so they didn't want people to be able to just get on a train and get out. So if you could, if they could, African-Americans would often sneak out in automobiles, and sometimes families who brought their cars back to the South would take out another car full of people. So the automobile becomes very important in fleeing from poverty in the South and in fleeing from the low wages of the South. Many African-Americans in the Great Migration move north, they get decent jobs. They're then able to move up in social class and also to purchase automobiles. So the reason that African-Americans preferred cars over public transportation was that public transportation was segregated. Buses were segregated and trains were segregated. Bus stations and train stations were segregated as well. And segregation was humiliating. African-Americans did not want to, if they could avoid it, did not want their families to have to face segregation. They didn't want their children to have to face segregation. And they wanted to make sure, and here you see a segregated a train car. So the importance of the automobile is even greater because African-Americans were then free to have their own vehicle, to have kind of a private space, a private and personal space that opened up personal freedom for them. And so by the 1950s, African-American families who were upwardly mobile in the growing middle class could purchase automobiles, and they're starting to become consumers, and they're starting to become consumers of travel, just as white families were consumers of travel, and just as they were consumers of percolators and television sets. They were also consumers of travel. They wanted to go on vacation. They wanted to see the sights. They wanted to see the country. And they wanted to educate their children. But it's important to think about the meaning of the automobile and which automobiles African Americans chose, because they were very specific in their choices of the automobile. This is the interior of the Buick Electra. African-Americans chose Buicks more than any other automobile. And there were several reasons for this. First of all, the Buick was very roomy. It was large. If you were an African-American with a car, you needed a car that would carry a lot of stuff. You had to carry blankets and pillows with you in case you couldn't stop at a hotel. You had to carry food with you in case you couldn't stop at a restaurant. You might have a couple of cans of gasoline that you carried in your trunk because you didn't know if you could get gas at a gas station. You might carry a couple of gallons of water because you didn't know if you would be able to find water if you had an overheated radiator. So African Americans needed a lot of stuff. They needed big, heavy trunks, and they also needed large cars because they perceived of them as safer, and they perceived of them as harder to turn over if you encountered an angry mob. African-Americans were also very proud of their cars. And I love this photograph of Chuck Berry with his Cadillac. Many of the people who traveled in the Jim Crow era were performers or sports figures like baseball players. And most of those folks could afford to have really big, beautiful cars. And in their biographies and their autobiographies, they always justify the reason that they purchased a Cadillac. White Americans never felt the need to justify their reason for buying a Cadillac, but African Americans always felt that they had to justify it. Even Cadillac went so far as to say they didn't want African Americans buying their cars. They didn't think it was the right image for them. So African-Americans continued to buy large cars or to get someone else to buy the car for them. But their reasons for having large cars was very different from the reason that white Americans wanted large cars. This is Medgar Evers, who was a field secretary for the NAACP. And he went out to investigate lynchings. He went out to investigate church burnings. And his car, the car that he chose, was the Rocket 88. And that is this car right here. Now, the Rocket 88 was a really fast car. If you just touch the accelerator, the car would take off. And for Medgar Evers, this was incredibly important because he could outrun the Klan. He could outrun a pickup truck. And also the car was wide enough that he was over 6 feet tall, that he could sleep on the front seat or in the back if he needed to. So you can see that the reason that African-Americans chose specific makes of cars was very different from the reason that white Americans chose particular cars. And this is the view of Medgar Evers' car. He was shot and killed beside his car in 1963. So I won't say that cars were not a status symbol for African-Americans, because they were. You know, it was very important that you have a really good looking car, and here this family, they look really good too with their raccoon coats. But for African-Americans, the car was often their largest purchase. And it was their largest purchase because they couldn't buy a house. Houses were often redlined, and banks and realtors colluded to prevent African-Americans from being able to get mortgages. This was part of what we call systemic racism. So if you couldn't get a mortgage, if your house was within a Black neighborhood and your neighborhood was redlined and you couldn't get a mortgage to buy a house, the next largest purchase, of course, would have been an automobile. So African-Americans had more disposable income to put into their automobiles because they couldn't always buy houses. So let's talk a little bit about the intersection between race and space. We're going to talk a little bit about what the geography of the nation tells us about the automobile and African-Americans and their automobiles. So before the automobile, let's stick with this slide for a minute. Before the automobile, people didn't go very far from home. If you think about, I live in upstate New York, and if you think about the distance between towns, you might go 7 or 8 or maybe 10 miles and there's another little town. And that little town has a Presbyterian church, and you go 10 more miles and there's another Presbyterian church, and 10 more miles and there's another Presbyterian church. And the reason there are so many little churches with its own Presbyterian church is because people didn't go very far. You didn't go very far from home. You were able to walk to the store or walk to the church or walk to whatever business that you needed downtown. You didn't go very far. Most people stayed within a few miles of home. But the automobile opens up new avenues for you, right? You can go to a church that's 10 miles away or 20 miles away or 30 miles away. You can travel to different states and other parts of the country. And it really starts to open up the country in ways that it hadn't been opened up before. But sadly, many parts of the country were perceived of as white space. They were perceived of as places that white people wanted to keep white and not allow African-Americans to enter. And so you start to find signs on a landscape that's littered with really damaging messages. So even though the automobile opens up a lot of freedom on the road, you have a landscape that's littered with messages that are very negative and quite racist. So like this welcome to Klan country sign, or like this is a fast food restaurant that was on the West Coast throughout California and throughout Utah, the Coon Chicken Inn, nationally famous. And this was the banner across the street in Greenville, Texas. Greenville, welcome, the blackest land, the whitest people. So you can imagine how intimidating these kinds of signs would be if you were traveling across the country or going on vacation. And of course, throughout the country, there were hundreds and hundreds of sundown towns. And a sundown town was a town that you were not permitted to be in after the sun set. So for African Americans, you could work in these communities. You could be a maid or a cook or a chauffeur, but you were not allowed to be in the town after sunset. And there's an incredible story about Thurgood Marshall, who was standing on a train platform, just waiting for a train. And a man with a gun walks up to him and says, and asks him what he's doing there. And he says, I'm just waiting for the train to Shreveport. And the man says to him, well, you better be on that train because the sun has never set with a nigger in this town. And that was a story that he recounted in his autobiography. But this existed in towns throughout the United States. And not only were the towns in the Midwest, but the Darien, Connecticut was a sundown town. So there were sundown towns all over the United States. And of course, when African Americans went out on the road, there was concern. There was fear of violence, like this couple that actually got caught by an angry white mob who was trying to turn over their car. So African Americans liked highways. They loved highways because the highway freed you from having to go through little towns where you didn't know how welcoming or unwelcoming the community would be. But at the same time, highways also, when they were originally built, were often put through Black neighborhoods and destroyed Black neighborhoods. So again, it's a double-edged sword for African Americans and when you're talking about travel and mobility. And this I thought was a particularly terrifying image of a fair. Imagine encountering this group of folks at, this is the Colorado fair. So how did African Americans respond to these assaults on their freedom? Well, from 1936 to 1966, a man named Victor Green produced a book, a little booklet called The Negro Motorist Green Book. He produced it in New York City. And it was basically a guide for African Americans traveling in the United States. And it included things like hotels and motels, garages where you could get your car fixed, drugstores that would be welcoming to African Americans, roadhouses and tourist homes and guest houses. So it was really your guide to places that would be welcoming to you when you were traveling in the United States. And keep in mind, the Green Book was just one of many, many guides that were available to African Americans when they traveled. The mantra of the Green Book was travel is fatal to prejudice. And Victor Green really believed that if people would just get to know one another, if they would just encounter if African Americans would just encounter white people and white people would just encounter African Americans through travel, that would reduce racism. This is Victor and Alma Green, his wife. And I always like to talk about Alma because sometime in the late 1950s, Victor Green gets sick. And I don't know what happens to him, but he ultimately dies in 1960. But in the late 50s, he's no longer capable of running the business, the Negro Motorist Green Book Publishing Company. And so that role is taken over by Alma, and Alma is running the Green Book with four other women. So it's a totally woman-run, owned and operated publishing business, which was really unheard of in the 1950s. So Alma was really a pioneer. And Victor continued to be the face of the Green Book, but Alma was really running it. And people always ask me, how did they find out what places people could stay in? Because it was a national publication. It listed places by state all across the United States. Of course, the very beginning of the Green Book, it starts out in New York, New Jersey, Massachusetts, and very gradually it expands. And it expands first to the Northeast and then the entire East Coast. And then it pushes out to Chicago and then the entire United States. And then by the end of its run in 1966, it's reaching the Caribbean, Europe, Africa, Asia. It's really reaching out to the entire world. And the way they found places, there were a couple of ways. Word of mouth was one. So if you stayed in a place that you thought was a great hotel or ate at a great restaurant that was welcoming to African-Americans, you wrote to Victor Green and told him. So he sent out letters asking people about places that they had stayed, and he got quite a response. He also had agents all over the country. He was a mailman, and he found these agents who knew about places to stay. One of them, Mrs. Bass, who worked at the Piney Woods School in Alabama, her job at the Piney Woods School was to book the music groups. She used to book the Cotton Blossom Singers and the Blind Boys of Alabama and all of these music groups that the school had. And as a result, she knew, they went and sang all over the country, and she knew the places that they could stay. And so she was one of Victor Green's agents that gave him tips about places to put in the Green Book. And as the Green Book grew, more and more places reached out to him and asked if they could be included. And if you think about it, Victor Green gave small mom and pop places and places that never would have been able to afford marketing, he gave them national publicity. And I actually opened up my facsimile Green Books here because I wanted to see what places were in Massachusetts. And there were quite a few places in Boston, the Harriet Tubman Hotel on Holyoke Street, the Slade's Restaurant on Tremont Street. There were places in Cambridge and Great Barrington, Hyannis and North Cambridge, Needham and Pittsfield, Provincetown and Randolph and South Hanson and Springfield. Springfield had the Springfield Hotel on Main Street, Worcester, Wareham. And there weren't a lot of places in each one of these towns. Pittsfield seems to have had three tourist homes. Great Barrington had three, which is the home of W.E.B. Du Bois. But there were a few restaurants as well. So there were quite a few places in Attleboro, and there are quite a few in Boston. So there were places in all of the New England states. Most of the largest number of Green Book sites were in, of course, Harlem, where Victor Green was located. I think there were 244. And they get to be pretty thin when you get out west. And of course, there are relatively few Black people in some of the states of the West. So that makes sense. But Victor Green's Green Book lasts longer than any other of the travel guides. And there was Grayson's Guide and Travel Guide, the Traveler's Guide. There were dozens of them. So why does the Green Book last? Why is that the one we've heard of? Well, Victor Green was a very savvy businessman, and he made a deal with Standard Oil, which is Esso. Esso, which we call now is Exxon. He made a deal for them to circulate the Green Book. They bought thousands of Green Books and they gave them out or sold them at Esso gas stations. And they also were the gas station that permitted African-Americans to use their restrooms. That was very important to African-Americans who were traveling, that they knew if they stopped at an Esso gas station, it was most likely that they would be treated with decency and respect, and that they would be permitted to use the restrooms. And so African-Americans tended to use Esso gas stations, and that's the place that they could also pick up a Green Book. And here you can see the cover of the 1948 Green Book. And I love this one because it's just such it's so middle class. Victor Green has told us who he's cultivating here. He's got this young middle class couple, light skinned with their mixed, their perfectly matched luggage, their suburban house. And you can see just a little bit of their car. He was courting the Black middle class, as well as Black business travelers. And this is the time period when large corporations are starting to hire African-American men as executives. Not many, one or two in each corporation, but they're just beginning to hire these executives. And these executives have to travel. And as they travel, what they were finding was that they couldn't stay in the same hotels that their white counterparts, the people they were traveling with, could stay in. And so the Green Book provided an invaluable guide to provide places for them to stay. And just to give you an idea of some of the other places that African-Americans looked to for travel information, this is the cover from the 1942 Afro Travel Map that was produced by the Baltimore Afro-American newspaper. And you can also see their audience here at the top. They included Black golf courses. So clearly courting a middle-class audience. And the types of places that they could stay ranged from colored YMCA dorm rooms like this one to Rock Rest. And Ken asked me if I would talk a little bit more about places in New England. And this is one of my absolute favorites. It's in Kittery, Maine. It is, if you've been to the National African American Museum, you'll see this rock, which is now in the collection and it's on view. Rock Rest was a tourist home. It was a place that you went and stayed for 1 or 2 weeks. Richard Candy, who is an old friend of mine and an alum of the Cooperstown Graduate Program, called me on a Wednesday, and I remember this so well, a Wednesday about 20 years ago, and said that I needed to come and see Rock Rest, that it looked as if it had just been vacated, like they had closed the door and locked it and never touched it again. And I said, wow. And he said, and there's a diary, a travel diary. And so he called me on a Wednesday. That Friday, I put my husband and son in the car and we drove to Maine. And I documented Rock Rest. This is one of my photographs. And the interior. And I was glad that I did because it subsequently the plaster fell. So it never looked the same again. But interestingly, we called working with the folks in Kittery, we called the Smithsonian, got the Smithsonian's new museum then in the planning stages to come and get some of the artifacts. So many of the artifacts have been preserved. But this is what Rock Rest looks like. And it's a very interesting problem because obviously, if you were thinking about this for a National Trust site, you would say, oh, well, this is not architecturally important, but it is incredibly important as a historic site related to African-Americans and the African-American experience. And just a couple of slides of Rock Rest. It was operated by the Clayton family, the Sinclair family, Hazel and Clayton Sinclair. And she always set this beautiful table with her Depression glass and her fancy china, very, very elegant tables that she set. And here you can see some of the women enjoying lunch. Not only did they provide a tourist home, but they provided catering services. So there would be elegant luncheons and dinners at Rock Rest. The Rock Rest collection also included manuscript materials. And this is a letter. And of course, people in the 1950s, they didn't always call, they wrote letters. So here is a woman writing to Mrs. Sinclair, asking her if she could, if there's a place that she, if for her for 2 weeks in August. So people did come to Rock Rest. They would stay for a week or two. People came back year after year. They were physicians. They were teachers. They were clergy, and it was a place to relax, to be away from the racism that they faced the rest of their lives. It was a place where they could meet their children, could meet marriage partners. And it was just a place where they could be near the beach. Although Rock Rest is not on the beach. It's a few miles away from the beach. And these are her famous lobster plates. You can see that even her glasses were are right there in the middle, that when you walked into the house, it was exactly as it had been left And her glasses were on one of the lobster plates. And there were other types of accommodations as well. This is a typical motel, the kind of motel where you pull your car right up to the front door. And this one is in Hot Springs, Arkansas, McKenzie Court, the South's finest Negro court. And if you open the book, open the green book, many of the pages included ads like this one. And the owners of these businesses took pictures of themselves and included them in the ads. And I think the rationale for that was to say, look, I'm African-American too. You'll be welcome here. We will treat you right. One of the places that African-Americans wanted to go, but were hesitant to go, was the national parks, and actually are still hesitant to go. The National Park Service has had a really rough time getting Black visitors at the national parks. And I think one of the reasons is that African-Americans don't have a history of going to these places or being welcome at the national parks. Even though the national parks have always said that they were welcoming to everyone, it's true that the national parks permitted African-Americans to visit. The problem was that all of the concessions in the national parks, the guest houses, the cabins, the parking lots, the restrooms, all of the concessions were segregated. And this is a photograph of the segregated picnic grounds for Negroes. So even though you went to the national parks and you could go into the national park and not be segregated, if you were staying in the national park, you were in a segregated facility. And that was not the doing of the federal government, but the private concessionaires. So the automobile becomes important not only for travel for vacations, but also as a tool in the struggle for civil rights. And this is an ad, by the way, from the Green Book. When African-Americans were involved in the civil rights marches, demonstrations, boycotts, they had to have places to stay and they had to have places to eat. And the tourist homes, the guest houses, the restaurants provided those places of respite for the marchers, both Black and white. And this at the front of this march here, holding the Equal Opportunity and Human Dignity sign, we see Al Hibbler, who is a famous, relatively famous jazz musician. And here is the motel that he was staying at, the A.G. Gaston Motel in Birmingham. And this is the motel just after it was bombed. So these people, who were generally considered to be quite conservative, not always openly involved in civil rights, they were at risk because their hotels, their businesses, were being used for civil rights. They were supporting the civil rights movement, and they were in danger of being hurt themselves or having their businesses destroyed, as was done at the Gaston Motel. And the automobile was essential to the movement. And one of the reasons was that if you're thinking about registering voters or providing healthcare or providing education or training, you needed a car to travel around a state or to even travel around a county. To investigate burnings, church burnings, or to investigate lynchings, you needed a car. And so the car becomes crucial. Excuse me, it becomes a tool that's used to make that travel, to make that necessary travel around a county or around a state. And it was also essential to the boycotts. So if you think about the Montgomery bus boycott, here you see Martin Luther King on the right, ushering these women into this car. In order for the boycott to be successful, you needed vehicles that would take people to work. If they couldn't go to work, they couldn't hold on to their jobs. And so Martin Luther King and the organizers of the Montgomery bus boycott purchased a small fleet of cars, and they used those cars. They had volunteers driving those cars and picking up people and taking them to work. That way they didn't have to ride on the buses and they were able to bankrupt the Montgomery Bus Company. They cut their revenue by 69%, which was absolutely incredible. The other reason that automobiles were important in the movement was because cab companies were segregated, and only white cab companies were allowed to pick up white people at airports. And so if you were a civil rights worker and you were flying into a southern city, Atlanta, a Birmingham, or Selma, any southern city, you could not get from the airport to your hotel. But this new thing called a rental car enabled you to, you could rent a car and then get to your hotel since you couldn't take a cab. And that made it absolutely essential that these rental cars became essential ways that civil rights workers could move around in the South. So how does my story end, or does my story end? Throughout the time period, the NAACP and the Urban League and other organizations are petitioning the courts. They're filing lawsuits to open up public accommodations. They want to make sure that African Americans can use hotels and can use restaurants, and that this is unconstitutional to segregate hotels and restaurants and public accommodations. The 1964 Civil Rights Act does this. It breaks open Hilton Hotel and Howard Johnson's, which are two of the main lawsuits. And this means that now African Americans can stay at hotels and motels, mainstream hotels and motels. What does this do to the tourist homes, the guest houses, this network of Black businesses across the country? Well, many of them go out of business. It's also at the same time that we're building more and more hotels, and we're starting to see urban renewal. And urban renewal is destroying more of these businesses. So if you're thinking about the Green Book sites, only about 3% of them are still extant today. But I think we need to think about, going all the way back to the beginning, that relationship between African Americans and law enforcement. So when African Americans still go out on the road, they are twice as likely as white Americans to be stopped by the police. And the police view many of the traditions that African Americans usually had, like having pillows and blankets in the car. Policemen might see that as people not wanting to stop because they're drug dealers. You know, when the other reason was that African Americans carried those blankets and pillows because they thought they might have to sleep in the car. And it's interesting that many of the traditions that come out of segregation, come out of the Jim Crow era, African Americans still observe. They've become part of tradition as opposed to necessity, carrying all your food, for example, or carrying blankets and pillows. This is Philando Castile, who was shot in his car while during a traffic stop. And of course, you're all familiar with George Floyd, who was sitting in his car when he was dragged out. So we're still facing, in the 21st century, African Americans being profiled, racially profiled by the police, and pulled out of their cars, and sometimes being murdered. So one of the things I think that I would like to come out of this project is for people to think about how they could work with their local police departments, how they could work with local law enforcement to think about how they address traffic stops, how important it is to be aware of the bias that we all perhaps share about Black people, and how this is continues to be a crisis, actually, in our country. That really came to a head this summer. And that is my slideshow. That was, by the way, a Buick. Are there any questions?
Oh, yes. I'm coming back on here. Thank you, Gretchen. That was amazing. And, you know, having read the book and seen the movie, it's, so to speak, it's really good to see this presentation too. And I urge people to both read the book. How can people get the book?
They can go to bookshop.org. I always say bookshop.org because you can get it on Amazon, but if you go to bookshop.org, you can support independent booksellers.
Great. So we do have, I just want to remind people that they can still write questions into the chat or the Q&A. And we have several that I'm going to start with. One was, do you know which car company was the first to advertise to African-American consumers? Was it the Buick?
You know, that's a great question. And I don't know the answer. I would suspect that it was Ford. Ford was a raging anti-Semite.
Yes.
However, he was the first to hire African-Americans to work in the automobile plants. And Fords, African-Americans did buy Fords in pretty good sized numbers because they were cheap. You could get a Ford if you couldn't go into a showroom and buy a Buick, you could always buy a Ford used. So there were a lot of used Fords out there. That's a good question. I'm gonna have to see if I can find the answer to that. But I would guess that it was a Ford. The way that I know what kinds of cars people bought is because there were a series of market studies that were produced in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. And they were produced by the Black newspapers. And their goal was to figure out what kinds of products Black people bought so that the newspapers could then go to those companies and say, see, we are a market for your product. So they, you know, it's like Black people bought gold medal flour. I mean, they were really specific. It's like gold medal flour, Morton salt, you know, it was very, very specific on the products. And they were very, they asked people about their cars. And that's where all the information on cars comes from. And they were very city specific. So they did it in New York, in Pittsburgh, in Boston, in Baltimore, Washington, DC. I mean, they were very city specific, but even throughout the country, the most popular car was the Buick.
We've got another car related question from Jacqueline, and that has to do with being able to purchase cars. Mm-hmm. They were much more affordable than a house. So mm-hmm. was that the reason that people were able to afford cars?
Right. Well, you could afford a car because you couldn't buy a house. That was one reason. But no matter what, you could put together enough money to buy a used car. And in that time period, you could get a used car for a couple hundred dollars. Mm. I mean, you could actually get a used Ford for a couple of hundred dollars. I know my father's first car was a Model T. Was it Model T? Yeah. And I thought, really? That was your first car? That jalopy? But yeah, there were still a lot of them on the road. So you could buy a used car even if you couldn't buy a new car. And people did, those that couldn't afford a new car bought used cars. And sometimes families would get together and get a car. But it was only a few thousand dollars for a brand new car if you bought a Ford.
Wow. So you mentioned national parks were not someplace that were generally visited. And Melinda asked about beaches. You mentioned Rock Rest. Well, that's close to the shore. Mm-hmm. So were there beaches that welcomed or deemed safe? Were they listed in the Green Book and the other guides?
They didn't generally list the beaches, but the beaches were definitely segregated. And when you went for example, if you went to Atlantic City, there was a Black beach in Atlantic City. If you went to Martha's Vineyard, There was a Ink Beach is in Martha's Vineyard, you know, and that was the Black Beach. So the beaches were absolutely segregated. They might be side by side with the white beaches, but they were absolutely segregated.
Right. So you didn't mention this, but a lot of your book is really personal. And for those who you who didn't get it, one of the early slides was of a young little girl with her brother and a license plate behind them with 56. And that was Gretchen and her younger brother. But it, a lot of this book was personal for you. Could you just talk briefly about that and your family experience?
I guess I didn't, when I started the research, I was a little thick-headed and I didn't realize it was personal. I was really, I really started thinking about the Green Book. And I had never heard of it before. So, you know, I didn't think of it as my own story. It's actually this cover that a colleague of mine, mm-hmm. Showed it to me and said, have you ever heard of this thing before? And I said, absolutely, this is 20, 25 years ago. And I said, no, I never heard of it before. And so I started digging into it. And then as I started to interview people, and I'm a public historian, so I do a lot of oral histories. And I started interviewing the people that would have been the age of the drivers during the Jim Crow era. So people that were in their 80s and 90s. And as I started interviewing them, I was getting these same stories that my parents had told about travel and about, and it started to dawn on me, well, people carried all their food. And then these folks would say to me, well, we carried all our food because we knew we couldn't stop at a restaurant. Well, it dawned on me that we always carried all our food when we traveled. My parents never said why. and it never dawned on me that that was the reason, that segregation was the reason. So as I did my oral history interviews, I started to see that this story was intensely personal and it started to fill in holes for me. And then I interviewed Spencer Crew, who was then the director of the American Museum of the National Museum of American History at the Smithsonian. And we both realized that we were the kids in the back seat when our parents were taking us on vacation, when our parents were driving back south to visit relatives, and we were clueless. We were absolutely unaware, and they didn't share the story of segregation with us because they didn't want us to be humiliated, to feel badly about it, to think about it. And so those stories were never part of the narrative. But as I interviewed people, I realized this is my narrative. It just was filling in the holes. So I started to write down some of the stories that I remembered of going on vacation and starting to understand the family dynamic and the family stories, putting it all together. I realized, wow, this is my story. It's kind of self-discovery.
Right. So we've got another question from Jacqueline. I think you covered this in the book. Was it difficult for African Americans to purchase their car? Were there many dealerships that were owned by African Americans?
Relatively few dealerships. The first one was, I think, Davis Motors in Detroit, of course. And that wasn't until the 50s. So for African Americans had to either buy their cars from white dealerships if they would sell to them, and Cadillac generally would not sell directly to African Americans, but they were able to get Cadillacs anyway. I mean, some dealerships would. It depended on the dealership, and a growing number of dealers, black dealers, after the 1950s. So in the 60s and 70s, you have a growing number of dealerships, but there were some dealerships that were happy to sell a car to, if you had the money, they would take your or you could buy a used car.
So Peter had an interesting question. Do you know if authorities made it difficult for African Americans to get driver's license? Because we know they made it difficult about getting a lot of other things.
Yes, and I don't think so. And the reason I don't think so is because it was perfectly acceptable for African Americans to be truck drivers, to be cab drivers, and to be chauffeurs. So it was accepted as a role that African Americans could have to be drivers, to be in service to whites. So I don't think it was very hard at all to get a driver's license.
Interesting. So Lorna asks, where was the Green Book available for purchase?
Good question. I think it was available for purchase. It's got a number on it. Usually it says, 75 cents or something like that. I think it was probably available in Black communities and Black neighborhoods. It was definitely available at Esso gas stations. And I'm not sure if they sold it or not. I know that they bought thousands of copies. I assume that they gave them out for free because there's some reference to them being given out. It's possible. I've seen a few copies that are stamped on the back by the particular gas station. So it was like it was an ad for that gas station. I assume those gas stations either purchased them or they got a stock of them. Then they stamped the blank space on the back with their own personal information and handed them out. But I would assume that you could definitely buy them in Harlem. And there are probably some other outlets around the country. And I think he mailed them as well.
I keep looking at yard sales and I haven't found one yet.
Oh, they're hard to find, especially now. I think the Smithsonian paid something like $40,000 for one.
Wow.
And they are absolutely on junky paper. I mean, the paper is the, they were made to be thrown away. And I think most people did throw them away. They're really cheesy paper.
So we've got a couple questions that relate to this. And this was one I was very interested in too. James asks about the recent fictionalized portraits that deal with the Green Book. Of course, there's the movie, but most recently it was a major part of Lovecraft Country. Yep. And you're kind of in Lovecraft Country right now. Yeah, that's kind of frightening, but yeah.
I have not seen Lovecraft Country. I have seen the sets because my son sent me the photographs of the sets. So I haven't seen the sets. I haven't seen I don't get HBO. So we're going to have to find a way to see it. But I've heard that the sets are really good and the sets look great. The Green Book movie is, I call it a Hallmark movie. It's the way we wish things were. It's very happy. It's got a happy ending. Racism is gone. Everybody hugs. It's not really about the Green Book and it's not really very accurate, but it's definitely a happy movie. It introduced the Green Book, so I guess that's good.
You should take a look at Lovecraft Country.
Is it good?
It's good. It's good.
My son told me it was a little bloody. He said, "Mom, I don't know if it would scare you or not."
It's a little it's a little bloody and it's a little weird, but so is H.P. Lovecraft. Mm-hmm. Someone asked, can you find the Green Book content online?
Yes. If you go to the New York Public Library, the New York Public Library has all of the Green Books online and you can read them by page, go through the pages. So if you just type in NYPL Green Book, it'll come up.
Excellent. Well, before Claire comes back and puts a plug in for what's coming up next, I just want to put a plug in because we were very fortunate several years ago. Gretchen sent us a fabulous intern who I got to work with, Jacob Barry. And he did a great project, which you can find on our website called African American Vacationers in New England. And he did some work on Red Rock and also on Martha's Vineyard. So Rock Rest. Yeah, he did work on Rock. Yeah, what did I say?
Red Rock.
Oh, I said Red Rock. That's here in Lynn. I'm sorry. Red Rock Crescent. African-American vacationers in New England. If you put that in, when you get to the Historic New England website, you can find something on that. So Gretchen, again, thank you for doing this. I know you've been, well, virtually on the road a lot talking about the book and the series. And again, I urge anyone, if they can, get a copy of the book and to find the PBS movie. I think you'll really enjoy it. It's moving and it's thought-provoking and it's also disturbing at the same time. So, Claire, I'll turn this back to you.
Yes, thank you so much. That was fascinating. And thank you for talking about Rock Rest. I remember seeing that in the museum in DC, and it's really cool to hear more about it and to see the inside of it, which, you know, not many people get to see. Yeah. So I just wanted to let you all know about a few more programs that we're doing. So next Thursday, we have another program about Sarah Oren Jewett, which we owned her house, which is also in Southern Maine. So that is next Thursday. It's about one of her books, looking for the first gay American novel, which should be fascinating. Look at her writing. And if you want to see more of our upcoming virtual programs, I've also put the link for all of our virtual programs in the chat. And then my email as well, if you have questions, feedback, anything you want me to know about this or any of the upcoming programs, you can always email me. I just want to thank our panelists and thank all you for attending, and I hope to see you at another historic New England event soon.
And
good night, everyone.
One last word, Gretchen, say again what that site was that people could buy the book at. Someone asked and they couldn't find it in the chat. Oh. I know you put it in there.
I think it was bookshop.org, right?
Bookshop.org.
Bookshop.org. Yep, Yeah, I just put that in there. It is a great way to support local booksellers during this time.
They also support independent Black book.
Mm-hmm. Ah, great. Well, thank you again, and we hope to see you at another time, Gretchen.
Thanks.
We appreciate it. All right, good to be with you.
Good night.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.